Hello.
Well, hi, how are
Jeez,
you?
Geez, not a busy day, huh? Good to see you.
Well, good to see you.
Thank you very, very much. My daughter, Erin, that you
Hello.
Met
before.
My fiance, Marla.
Hello.
Hello there.
Nice to see you again.
My father.
How are you, sir?
Hello there. Nice
seeing you. Sister Barbara.
Hello.
Mr. Fitzgerald.
Hi. Hello there.
Ms. Matova.
Hello.
Mark Marino.
Pleasure to see you again.
Hello.
Mike Forge.
Hi, how are you?
Dick Maurice.
How
are you? USA.
Well, I think we've gotten individuals with all of that.
Okay. Sister. Monica, what's that? Where do you want to start?
Let me see. Maybe somebody from over here.
Sir, why don't you, okay, why don't you come over the other end?
Okay, right.
Thank you, sir.
You're the only one that's ever done it.
Yeah, man, baby.
The horses while they're
actually, he makes sure they're fed.
Well, listen, I think everyone's most grateful for all that
Thank
you've done.
Thank you very, very much.
How about those young men and women you see out there?
They're unbelievable.
They're just that's the way I feel. I'm more proud of them than anything. Do you know that we, in these last few years, have the highest percentage of high school graduates in the military that we've ever had in our history, even when we were at war? And there's three intelligence brackets that they use for assigning people to duties. We have the highest percentage in the top bracket that we have ever had in our history. Man, I'm going out there. I just get so proud of them.
Well, when you see an 18-year-old piloting a carrier through football fields long, it's...
Well, that's got to be.
Yeah.
Got to be something
phenomenal.
Well, I'll tell you for myself, we're very proud of you.
Yes, we are.
Fantastic job. I want to change the Constitution again, get you to run another term.
Well, I'll tell you what I've promised myself. I can't do it for me. That wouldn't be right. But when I'm out of here, I'm going to get out on the mashed potato circuit and I'm going to try to whip up interest in canceling that for future presidents, because it's just dawned on me. Mm-hmm. Good Lord, we've got congressmen and senators who've been there 40 years.
You're right.
This is the only office that is elected by all the people. I think it's an invasion of the people's rights that they should be entitled to vote for who they want to vote for.
It's true.
As long as they're
right.
So,
can we come with you when you go out and campaign for that?
Huh?
Can we come with you when you go out and campaign for that?
All right.
Some presents from a member of Vegas headliner. Since you were nice enough to pose for photographs, these are for you. You know? Remember these days in Las Vegas?
Oh, yeah. Oh, this was when we did that German routine. I remember I introduced him to the fact that back in vaudeville, the great German comedians that always did it, you know, with the sort of hokum language, actually, the bulk of them were all Irish. And so the next thing we knew, why we were doing this whole routine, and the kind of...
Wonderful.
Language that, yeah, that was the king of it. Whatever happened?
The Last Frontier.
Oh, I know, yeah. But I mean afterward, because that's the only time I did that. That was rehearsed there. You know, MCA, they were after me and after me. This was when they first began, they were the names of Las Vegas and all. And they were after me, and I said, you know, I don't sing or dance, I'm an actor. Finally, they would at least come in and let us talk to you about it. So I said, okay. So I went in, and they said, you do a lot of benefits, don't you? And I said, all of us do. Sure, I do a lot of benefits. They said, what do you do when you do a benefit? And I said, well, you know what I do. I MC. And they said, well... And I said, you mean to tell me that they'd pay that kind of money you're talking about? And he said, yes, we'll have a show, and you'll present the show, and then we'll tie you in with one of the acts for the finale, where you will perform with one of the acts. And that's what the show was, and by golly, we had standing room.
Well, Well, Mr. Fitzgerald said that when you finish here, the Hilton is ready for you anytime you want to continue this act, right?
I think Wayne's weeks will give you the rest.
Listen, I'll support him anytime.
President, excuse me. I'd like to give this to Wayne on behalf of the USO and its World War II veterans. We'd like to express our appreciation for your tremendous efforts on behalf of American servicemen and women.
Thank you, sir, very, very much.
Yes, and I thank you, too.
Thank you, sir.
You've got five senators waiting to come and see
you. I'll be behind schedule for the rest of the day. Always happens that way.
Thank you, sir.
I love you, first lady. Well, listen, I sure will. She's in New York right now, so. Tell her tomorrow.
We'll see you soon.
All right.
Thank Mr. Chrisler, my students at school wanted to wish you the best and say thank you for everything that you do for them.
For heaven's sake, give them my best.
I will.
And young lady, nice to see you.
Thank you for having me up to sir.
Well, listen.
Thank you, sir.
Glad to be present when you made that award.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You make us feel proud to be American. Thank you.
That's the truth.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
See you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to see you, sir.
Mr. President, good to see you. Good to see you. Robert, why don't you come up here?
All right, chair.
We've got to wait. We've got a group of stills coming in.
Oh, here's Don.
And all I'm looking forward to hearing, but particularly looking forward to hearing about you're going to Turkey. I think that was great.
Thanks. I'm talking for a second first.
Must have said I'm excited.
We've got our stills coming in. Excuse me.
Armed Services Committee's over there sticking together. You know,
well,
it's right. Always the way.
The biggest piece is
they end up with all the money.
Well, Mr. President, I want to tell you, I never traveled with a more dedicated group, hardworking senators who are very passionate for purpose. I'm very happy to have the opportunity to come here today and support you on our trip. We appreciate the time you're giving us. When I appreciate what you did since I've been here very shortly. These are those same people that make to a
we can give you a first-hand view of exactly what this is.
Looking forward to it.
When do you leave? When do you leave for the summit?
March 5th. Let's see, this is 25th, about 5 days away, early next week.
Mr. President, we didn't have any choice but to be hard working. We started our meetings about 5 a.m. every morning. Right? We had to be hard working.
Maybe sometime we ought to try to do this the way there's one businessman that I've heard of who has a branch in North Carolina.
Oh, I see.
He stays on all the things, and they all have to be the ones to undergo jet lag.
That's real power, isn't it?
Sites can take a little time, probably the way to be approved. Dear Mr. President, I am cautiously optimistic that recent statements by Mr. Gorbachev and his associates in the Soviet leadership concerning their intentions to terminate their occupation of Afghanistan will be implemented in practice. It would be an historic victory for the courageous and tenacious Afghan people. And we can be proud that we played some role in assisting them in their fight. Nevertheless, I have been disturbed by recent reports that indicate that our aid program and political support for the Mujahideen may be subject to some pressure in order to accommodate a Soviet settlement of their occupation on terms which might have the unintended effect of facilitating a continued Soviet presence or role in Afghanistan's future. I believe that we should not adopt any policies that tend to reward the Soviet
Mr. Chairman?
I'm fine. How are you?
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Mr. President?
You're just like you, George, Mr. President.
How are you, Kenny?
Good show the other night.
Thank you. Well,
I'm here now.
No, I heard that. It's all good to see you. No, the rules are it's a working lunch, so you can talk with your mouth. I think we'll have to keep any secrets to ourselves because there are three ways of trash coming down here. I don't know if I believe it anyway.
Is he inside the election?
Somebody does that to it every day. So if you do that every day, you'll never have any
pleasure. Oh, I didn't know that. When you run something that every day, too, that's great.
Thank you. Yeah.
I've already traveled.
Yeah, we're going to have a couple for later. Jump on the season without
affiliates. About 65 this morning. And I thought that he said that web. It was 25 years.
So this is one of those times when I cannot criticize the weather any place because it's raining again.
Oh, okay.
We've been waiting for it, though. It's been pretty dry there. This is a rainy season.
Raining in Santa Barbara?
In California.
It never rained in Santa Barbara.
Never, never. What's the grass so good?
Likely to happen.
How is Emily?
That's very good.
Mr. President, are we going to sit still for Noriega's usurpation of civilian authority in Panama?
Well, there are some limits on what we can do, we're looking at that situation and people are meeting on it to see if there is anything that we can do.
Would we use military force, sir?
No, I don't think that's an answer.
What is your alternative?
Well, we're not
prepared to come up with any answers as yet.
Did you talk to him? Told him to step down?
No.
Do you think our troops or the canal are in danger in Panama?
No. I do not. I don't think there's any appetite on the part of anyone there, including Mr. Noriega, to take on the troops.
Sir, were we behind this? Were we behind all of this, Del Valle?
No. No.
We did know about it, however, didn't we?
Well, we've been very much aware of what's going on down there. But
we didn't encourage it at all?
No.
We're not unhappy that it took place, though.
We still want Noriega to stand trial under the law on those drug charges, don't we?
I assume so. This is the result of an indictment of a federal grand jury, and it should follow that course.
But what happens if we let Noriega get away with this?
I haven't got any answers for you right now on these things.
Do you think you'll have some later in the day?
Will Bush carry this out?
What? I thought you were going to involve yourself in Congress.
Are these all Robertson people? Do we hear them a prayer?
Thank you all.
Maureen, what are your thoughts? Could we go?
Goodbye, Sam.
I always want to tell when Sam says something like that, I always want the press to say, Sam, I don't feel for you, Brian.
Well, I've got to refer to some notes here, but first of all, I want to thank you all for coming to discuss the Super Tuesday primary in your states. And I commend all of you for your efforts to increase participation in the Republican primaries. Super Tuesday provides us with an opportunity to continue the trend of support for Republicans in the South that we started in 1980 and 1984. And you all helped me carry the South in both of those elections. And I thank you for the continued strong support that you've always shown to me and to our administration. All we have to do to convince those who share our values to vote in the Republican primary for the candidates of their choice. I say that's all we have to do and should do. The Republican Party is the party of the open door, the party of hope and opportunity. And we invite those who share our conservative values of work and neighborhood and family and peace and freedom to vote in the primary for the candidate of their choice. These conservative values, I think, are shared by the Southern voters and by our Republican candidates. And I think it's safe to say that any one of our candidates is head and shoulders above those others that are running in the other parties. None of their candidates understands that the reason for our more than 62 months of economic recovery is reduced federal spending, lower tax rates, and free markets. None of their candidates supports us on military aid for the Nicaraguan freedom fighters, on SDI, or on a strong defense budget. As most of you have been saying, the choice is clear. The conservative candidates are in the Republican primary, and the liberal candidates are in the other primary. You're all playing a key role in working toward making sure that our next president is a Republican. And I want you to know I'll be out there with you campaigning for our nominee once that decision has been made, and working for our Senate candidates and helping you to raise money wherever I can. Together, I know that we will elect another Republican to continue our vision and our policies. So I thank you again for your coming here. And now, as I say, the meeting is open, and I didn't let Sam see the paper. pleased to join you all here, and I thank you all for being here today. I've been hearing exciting news about the work you've been doing, and I'm anxious to read your reports. Also, I want to mention Dr. Ian McDonald and all that he's doing, and Lois Harrington, who is the charge of our White House conference on drugs, and for what they're doing. A great deal has happened since we last met in the summer of 1986. Many of you were already actively involved in the national crusade against illegal drugs at that time. I asked you to go back to your organizations and have your membership work for drug-free schools and workplaces, tougher penalties for the drug pushers, and increased awareness by all Americans that illegal drugs are deadly and they're wrong. The crusade for a drug-free America is now being waged on many fronts. I know that your efforts, your tireless work and commitment have played a major role. Americans in all walks of life are seeing the truth about drugs. Workers and employers, students and teachers are saying no to drugs and alcohol. I'm proud of the progress that we've made. The federal government and over half of the Fortune 500 companies today have established programs to achieve a drug-free workplace. States such as Missouri and New Jersey have established comprehensive anti-drug laws that include strict sanctions for illegal drug use and distribution. And these states are sending a clear message that illegal drugs and their use will not be tolerated. And the media is sending the message not only to America, but to the world. They're revealing the deadly truth about drugs on specials in the nightly news, in daily newspapers, and in weekly magazines. And let me add, I can't help being proud of the role someone close to me has played in teaching our young people to stay away from drugs. Nancy's doing a great job, and she regrets not being here with us today, but I don't know whether she's back here yet or not. She's been in New York for the last couple of days. America's students are just saying no to drugs as they never have before. For 13 years, I hope you haven't been told this, for 13 years we've conducted annual drug abuse surveys of thousands of graduating seniors in high schools across our country. Just last month, the survey of the class of 1987 came out and the news was the best ever. Use of cocaine by high school seniors in 1987 dropped by one-third since the year before, and almost all the students said it was wrong even to try a drug like cocaine. A new understanding is evident. Drug abuse is not a victimless crime. We all pay a price, and we cannot afford to tolerate illegal drugs or their users anytime or any place, whether in our home, our community, school, or at work. And I see your hand in the progress that we're making, the unselfish dedication to service of your members and others like you who make America the greatest nation on earth. That if we're to achieve our goal of a drug-free America, we must never allow our nation to again become complacent about illegal drugs. I know I can count on you to continue your efforts until we can win and drugs lose, and that's our challenge. That's the crusade that you're helping to lead. So please pass on my thanks to all of your members who are doing so much to unite our country against this deeply disruptive and corrosive evil.
Thank you, Mr. President. As you know, these people are doing terrific work, and their organizations are also. They're going to send us, some of them already have, reports of what they're doing, and we'll get that all to you. And we don't need to tell you, or I don't need to tell you, that what they're doing is so much better than what it was a few years ago. They've also suggested they wouldn't mind having a picture with you, so.
I'll go right back here and wait for each one of you to come up. I'll stand in front of that fellow on the horse there. Being a horseman myself, I keep wanting to tell him he's abusing that horse ticket. But I also have to tell you another one. You know that that Nobel Award up there, that's the Nobel Peace Prize. And Teddy won that for settling the Russo-Japanese War. But I like to tell mixed groups when they're in here sometimes that he did it really in the best of Republican traditions. he was sitting on a yacht.
This is Ted Calicott with the Benevolent and Protective Order of the Elks. Virgil Descant with the Knights of Columbus. Edward Gardner, Big Brothers, Big Sisters.
You're a part of Big Brothers Greater Los Angeles. Been supporting many years.
Richard Gunderson with the AIDS Association of Blue. Anton Kaiser with Kiwanis. This is their billboard that they've got out. Okay, we'll go this way. Susan Cayley, Junior League of Washington.
Confusion.
Yeah.
In love with the Boy Scouts. Keep walking. Loyal Order of the Moose. Betty? Pillsbury? Girls? There we go. Girl Scouts of USA.
Am I seeing right here? Is it legal work?
Good
afternoon. I said I'm the only Canadian in this room today.
Frank Siegel, National Exchange Club. Betty Sevchak with the American Medical Association Auxiliary.
Yes.
Marie Ward with the Needlework Guild of America.
This is a pleasure again.
And Gary Wilkinson with the USJCs.
And all those ladies wearing green.
It does seem to be a conspiracy.
Green. That tempted me beyond my strength to resist. The Secret Service detail gave me a birthday present, and it's a book on Ireland and the Irish. And many of them are family stories in there and things that have come down through the years in Ireland, and one that I've remembered and I like to tell, I just finished telling it to another group out here. This was the story of a little Irish girl who came home from school with a note. She'd been naughty. And so that night at dinner, the family was gathered around the dinner table, but she was over in the corner, had a little table all by herself, being punished at dinner. And then the family overheard her saying grace. She was saying, "Thank you, Lord Jesus, for preparing a table before me in the presence of my enemies." I like a little girl like that. Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.